everybody. Joy here for day two of ironwork here in the city of Charleston. Today we're going to be talking about 20th century ironwork here. I'm going to wait until a few more folks join us. In the meantime, you get a beautiful view of one of my favorite gates in the city. All right, looks like we're getting some folks joining us. I was super excited when we had somebody ask about ironwork because it gave me an excuse to do some research into it that I've been wanting to do and read some, read a book that I've been wanting to read. Short technical difficulty, we're good. All right. Any discussion of 20th century ironwork here in Charleston has to center around one man, a man named Philip Simmons. There were other blacksmiths in town, but nobody achieved what Philip Simmons achieved in his lifetime. Now, I'm standing in the parking lot of St. John's Reformed Episcopal Church. We're right behind Buist Academy, and I picked this area for a specific reason, because this is an area of inspiration, education, and faith for the man I'm going to talk about, Philip Simmons. So I chose this location to show you some influences in his life. Philip Simmons was born on Daniels Island on June 9th, 1912. He was raised by his grandparents on what he called Dan's Island. His great-grandparents were slaves. Philip learned that the work was hard then and remained hard. He grew up preferring a busy life of chores and tasks. In his youth, he lived the life of a Sea Island farmer and fisherman, like his grandparents. Schooling on Daniels Island was inconsistent at best for blacks. So when Philip Simmons was 8 years old, his family decided that he needed to come to Charleston and live with his mother and be educated in the city. He ended up actually going to Buist Elementary School. That's what it was called at that time. It later became Buist Academy. Now, on his way to and from school, he would pass by beautiful, elegant planters' houses and beautiful pieces of ironwork. It was said when he had a chance to draw, when he had art in school, he always drew ironwork. So it wasn't that much of a stretch that he actually became a blacksmith. In front of Buist Academy is this beautiful sign that later in life Philip designed and had put on the archway that faces Calhoun Street. This school was always important to him. Now, he learned attention to detail from his grandfather, who actually was a casket maker. So he learned attention to detail, hard work, and he learned about the relationship that a craftsman had with his client. He was heavily influenced by his African roots, and he preferred things be made the old-fashioned way, as he said. He never completely lost his Gullah speech patterns and his love of Geechee cuisine. Young Philip used to love to draw beautiful pieces of iron. In 1920, he found his way to Smithy Peter Simmons. No relationship to him. According to Philip, he was attracted to Peter's shop on Charlotte Street by the forge, its flames and heat, the glowing red iron bars, and the cascade of sparks. I imagine I would have been attracted to the same things that attracted young Philip Simmons when he was 11 years old. At 13, he finally quit school to become an apprentice for Peter. Peter was the son of a plantation blacksmith and had spent his early childhood in enslavement. He grew up during the Reconstruction, and he earned his fortune here in the Charleston area. In the 1920s, this was part of a waterfront district, and there were artisans and craftsmen all over in this area. Within a 5-block zone, there were 4 African American iron workers. There was a West Side group and an East Side group. Philip Simmons became part of the East Side group. Peter was what we would call today old school. He didn't have an electric forge. He didn't have an electric drill. He handmade all of his tools, his chisels. And that's how Philip Simmons was educated. Peter's son Lonnie also was an apprentice at that same shop. However, Philip was his favorite apprentice. He and Peter's son Lonnie were friends. And even though it was grueling, hard, physical work, they became friends and they had moments of enjoyment. Both of the gentlemen discussed in a book interview that they used to broil hot dogs and bologna on the forges. By 18, Philip Simmons had become a full blacksmith after a 5-year apprenticeship. Like many iron workers, Philip could also make horseshoes, wheels, and forge iron at a forge. 3 different skills. He had his own shop in 1938 and started to become specialized in decorative or ornamental artwork, which this is an example of. In the 1940s, Philip started working for a business owner named Krawcheck. And Krawcheck actually commissions Philip to make a back gate for his shop on King Street. However, Philip had a challenge that he faced his entire life. He had to make something beautiful out of something that didn't look like much when it started. He actually, in the 40s, had to use scrap metal because there was such a high demand on iron during World War II that all he could use was scraps. Obviously, he impressed the Krawcheck family. Why? They ended up owning over 30 pieces of his artwork. Over his 7 decades of career, Philip Simmons created over 500 pieces, including iron railings, balconies, window grills, fences, and gates. There were 5 iron gates by Philip along Stoll's Alley alone. In 1976, he created a star and fish gate for the Smithsonian. He also crafted smaller items like tools, shutter dogs, and fireplace pokers. Can you imagine your family owning a fireplace poker that was created by one of the greatest blacksmiths in America? He made these in his workshop, which was at his house on Blake Street. Now, one of the references that I relied heavily on is this book right here, written by John Michael Vlatch, called Charleston Blacksmith, The Work of Philip Simmons. I can't recommend it highly enough. It gives you a glimpse into Philip Simmons' life. Also, it has beautiful pictures of the ironwork that Simmons created throughout his lifetime. And it's a fascinating, fascinating read. In a separate essay, Now he gives them. In the midst of his time-bound trade, and even while preserving the historic appearance of Charleston, he remained his own man. He has found self-expression in the communal tradition. The National Endowment of the Arts bestowed Philip with a National Heritage Fellowship in 1982. During his acceptance speech, Philip remarked, "My instrument is an anvil. I guess some of you have heard me play a tune on the anvil, the old blacksmith's tune. I'm proud of that anvil, really proud. That anvil fed me when I was hungry, and that anvil clothed me when I was naked. That anvil put shoes on my feet." Now, during his interviews with Vlach, he talked about receiving visions as inspiration for his work. His use of a supernatural image is in fact a perpetration of a metaphor in widespread use in the African-American culture. African artisans see themselves moved by external forces outside of their control. By receiving visions, Philip is not only united to other African-American artists, but to the traditional African artist as well. Philip officially retired at 75. However, he continued to teach younger artisans late into life. It was said that he was an incredibly charming man who was very willing to talk to new artisans that expressed an interest in his work. In 2006, he received an honorary doctorate from South Carolina State. He was inducted into the South Carolina Hall of Fame in 1994. In 1998, South Carolina Governor David Beasley bestowed the Order of the Palmetto, the state's highest honor. In 2001, Philip was awarded the Elizabeth O'Neill Verner Governor's Award for a lifetime achievement in the arts. He died at Bishop Gadsden Retirement Community on June 22nd, 2009, at the age of 97 years old. So, Randy has been wandering around showing you beautiful topiary art and ironwork. We are standing in the Philip Simmons Commemorative Garden. In 1991, his church, this church right here, St. John's Reformed Episcopal Church, created a foundation, the Philip Simmons Foundation, for the development and development and maintenance of a commemorative garden. This garden was a gift from the Spoleto Festival USA on Simmons' 80th birthday. The topiary designs are by Pearl Fryer, a self-taught artist from Bishopville, South Carolina. He also added the heart-shaped stones that we're showing you right now. Now, supposedly, as the first part of this garden, there was a bell that Simmons brought from his workshop and donated to this garden. I can't find that bell. Trust me, I've looked as we've been wandering through. So I haven't been able to find that bell. Now, if you were with me on Saturday's video, bless you all for coming back. I don't know why you did it, but right over here is that clairvoyer that I was talking about. That little window in a solid wall that allowed you a glimpse into a beautiful garden. Ironwork in here was dedicated by Philip Simmons. Now, this is one of my favorite pieces here. I'm going to come talk a little bit about the heart gate. Now, this is the double gate on the Menotti side of the street. On the Anson entrance to this church, there is a single gate that repeats the cross and the heart motif. Now, this shows two influences. influences that were very strong in Philip's life: love and faith. So that's what he wanted these gates to evoke, was that sense of love of God and love for fellow man. This garden was completed in 1997 as part of Spoleto Festival's Human Nature exhibit. Now, as we walk around here, I know that Randy showed it before, but I want to focus on this beautiful bench here, which is very much a classical Charleston bench. And again, we have the heart design. However, it's a little bit different from that first heart design. And we're gonna walk over here. Now, if you guys want to know other places where you can go to see ironwork by Philip Simmons, you can go to Stoll's Alley. There are at least three still standing pieces of his ironwork. There are three gates there. One of my favorite gates is on St. Michael's Alley, and that's an egret. Now, he was famous for adding nature into his designs. He actually has a piece in the Smithsonian Museum called the Star and Fish Gate. And it has a fish that has the appearance of swimming through his use of wavy horizontal lines and a star, and that is in the Smithsonian. He also has pieces in the South Carolina State Museum. One of his pieces in there is a double egret gate. Like I said, this book is full of examples of his ironwork. On the front page, that is that double egret gate that is in the South Carolina Museum. So this gives you a way to kind of trace your way through the city and see the artwork that Philip Simmons gave to this city. It's said to be over 500 pieces, and actually he wanted people to have art in their lives. So a lot of times as he got older, he would do pieces for a very small commission just because he wanted people to have art in their life. Now, I went through this very quickly because I wanted you to see his artwork and I wanted you to have just a little kernel of understanding of his life. But if you get a chance, read more about him. He is truly a man of Charleston. He was raised here by people who were descended from the enslaved people. He carries in his artwork an African and an African American sense in his artwork of creating something beautiful out of nothing. I hope that you guys enjoyed today's video. I hope you enjoyed seeing this beautiful garden. If you come to Menotti and Anson Street and you turn left on Menotti, the entrance is at the back of the church. Please come enjoy this beautiful, beautiful place that was created with the artwork of a man named Philip Simmons to commemorate his contributions to Charleston. Thank you guys so much. Bye-bye.